all the appreciation from my side to all those who are here for this Facebook Live. This is Dr. Amarjan Agre welcoming you all in this session. We should appreciate the admin team of TAS for actually making this happen. We all are connecting and sharing our knowledge even in this corona pandemic only to better our services to the society. Interpretation of 2D echocardiography report is the most sought out topic I consider when we manage cardiac case for non-cardiac surgery. Interpretation of echocardiography report. As we all know, echocardiography is safe, it is non-invasive. Particularly, the transthoracic echocardiography is totally non-invasive. Transesophageal echocardiography is semi-invasive. It is a real repeatable technique or the modality of investigations which can be repeated again and again. And most of all, it is real time. Whatever is happening inside the heart can be actually seen on the screen, and then our management can be altered accordingly. So that is the beauty of echocardiography. Echocardiography provides a substantial structural and functional information about the heart. It can be applied in perioperative period, intensive care units, emergency situations, trauma, and also can be used as resuscitation aid. What's the importance of echocardiography? Why is it so important? Because echocardiography can assess the cardiac function in terms of the contractility of the left ventricle, right ventricle. It can actually tell us the chamber size and hypertrophy if at all it is present. It can tell us about and give information about the valvular dysfunctions. It can be very much useful. It can be proved very useful in cardiac tamponade cases. And it also can also detect pericardial and pleural effusions. Now, doing transthoracic echocardiography is actually not that difficult. There are only four windows or views which we have to study. These four windows will give us multiple views to study the various structures in the heart. But as such, if we know only the three windows of this four, that is the left parasternal long axis, then the apical and the subcostal, then much of the information can be sought out. Now, this is the actual echo report, what we get from the patient. This echo report usually has these following parameters, which I've written here. The echo report always mentions about the ejection fraction. Ejection fraction tells us about the systolic function of the heart. Then, mention about regional wall motion abnormality is always present in the echo report. What is that? We will see in detail. Then there is always a mention of diastolic dysfunction. And if at all the patient is of ischemic heart disease or coronary heart disease, then ischemic mitral regurgitation may also be present. If the patient has valvular dysfunction, that is mentioned over there. And any congenital heart diseases like ASD, that is atrial septal defect, ventricular septal defect, is also mentioned. Pulmonary artery pressures also are mentioned in the echo report. Let us see one by one. Let us start with the most important, that is the LV systolic function, which is written in terms of ejection fraction in the echo report. What is the importance of this ejection fraction? If the patient has a reduced ejection fraction, that means the patient has higher risk for post-operative heart failure. It is very, very important that even if pre-operative, the patient has a subnormal LV function or mild type of LV function, due to anesthesia, fluid management, and various other intraoperative complications, patient may land into severe LV dysfunction. And therefore, intraoperatively and postoperatively, it is very important that we take certain precautions so that our patients are safe. Ejection fraction, normally it is more than 55%, as we all know. It is termed as mild LV dysfunction if the ejection fraction is said to be between 45% to 55%. It is moderate LV dysfunction if the ejection fraction is between 30% to 45%, and severe LV dysfunction if the ejection fraction is less than 30%. How do we know that there is systolic dysfunction? Actually, if you are doing echocardiography and the probe is on the chest wall of the patient and you can see the echo on the screen, then you can see that the ventricular contractions is sluggish, or the ventricular wall does not thicken uniformly while contracting. But in report, it won't be seen as such, because even if the pictures are attached to the report, they are not live pictures. They are only pictures. So we cannot see the three-dimensional structure or the two-dimensional structure moving actually. So it is written in terms of regional wall motion abnormality. The same is ventricular wall does not thicken uniformly while contracting. I'll be explaining this. See, now this is the first video and this is the cross-sectional section of the LV. So you see a circular LV, right? Now here is our probe. When our probe is kept over here, this has to be the anterior area or the anterior wall of the LV. The opposite, you may say, is posterior, but it is termed as inferior. So this is anterior and this is inferior wall of LV. Since this is a cross section of the LV and our probe is kept on the anterior chest wall, this has to be the anterior wall of the LV. The opposite is the inferior wall of LV. This is the lateral wall of LV and here is the RV, and therefore this is the interventricular septum. So this is the septal wall of the LV. So now when this video is played, you will appreciate that all the walls of the LV, the inner wall of the LV, is coming inside equally. Also, when it is coming inside, it is thickening. That means its diameter is increasing. It is not thinned out. It is that walls are getting thickened. So this is normal. So now I'll play this video again and you can appreciate that the LV is contracting so well. So this is a normal LV function. You appreciate the contractility. You appreciate that all the walls of LV are moving equally inside, and also you appreciate that they are thickening equally. So this is the normal LV and a normal ejection fraction. Now I'll show you this video. You appreciate that it is not contracting that well. It is not thickening also fully or maximally, and the walls of LV do not come inside as they were seen in this video. So this ejection fraction, we can say that this may be around 30 to 35% ejection fraction. So what I was talking about, if you appreciate in this LV, this wall is moving, that is the inferior wall is moving, but the anterior wall is not moving at all. I'll play this. See, the anterior wall is not moving at all. Now you will see, if you see this, you will appreciate that the anterior wall is not moving, and because the anterior wall is not moving, this patient has just come as ischemic heart disease for some orthopedic procedure. Now this ischemic heart disease patient, you don't have his immediate medical history or consultation papers, and he's not on any drugs, but he is a 65 to 70 years old man, and you see the echocardiography yourself, you do, and you appreciate this, you suspect that the anterior wall is not moving, therefore this can be anterior wall motion abnormality. Okay, that is the regional wall motion abnormality on the anterior wall. So this wall is supplied by the left anterior descending artery, that is the LAD. Therefore this patient can have a LAD stenosis or a plaque, or he may have this coronary artery disease involving left anterior descending artery. So that is the inference. But now you don't do the echo and you have a echo report with that patient, and in that it is mentioned that the anterior wall of the LV and the anteroseptal wall and the anterolateral wall are akinetic. So what does that mean? Every echo report of an ischemic heart disease patient will have a mention about this, that some wall of the LV is either hypokinetic or akinetic. What does that mean? This is called as regional wall motion abnormality. So this is regional wall motion abnormality. There are 5 types of regional wall motion abnormalities, and actually the 4. And when you say normokinesia, this endocardium, that is the inner lining, the endocardium moves towards the center more than 30%. More than 30%, it has to come inside. Yes. So then it is called as normokinesia. When is mild hypokinesia? When it is coming inside from 10 to 30%. Okay. So 10 to 30% is coming inside the contractility of the LV, then it is mild hypokinesia. So any echo report, if it is written mild hypokinesia of the anterior wall of the left ventricle, you just think that, you just visualize such LV on the echocardiography of this patient, and you just think that the LV function is so reduced that the wall is only coming inside 10 to 30%, that means 20 to 25%. Okay. Now when do they say severe hypokinesia? Severe hypokinesia is just like that, when the anterior wall is moving very less. See, this is moving very less. Well, this segment is totally akinetic, and akinetic means it does not move at all. It does not move at all. So there can be a severe LAD stenosis in this patient. And what is dyskinesia? Dyskinesia is endocardium moves away from the center of LV. I have that slide also. I'll show you that slide. So when we say dyskinesia, endocardium moves away. So this is extreme regional wall motion abnormality. That means we can say there is extreme coronary artery disease. There is extreme myocardial supply demand ratio imbalance. Are you getting it? The akinesia and the dyskinesia are the extremes wherein we have to be very careful. If the echo report says there's akinesia of 2-3 segments or dyskinesia of 1 or 2 segments, we have to be very meticulous in our anesthesiology management and anesthesia management. Yes. So now let me show you this. This is something I was talking about. If you see, this is the center. The other walls are coming inside, but this wall is going outside. Ladies and gentlemen, are you here? Do you see this? This is extreme regional wall motion abnormality. This is extreme imbalance of myocardial oxygen supply and demand. Yes. So this is what, when it is written there's dyskinesia, we have to think that particular part or wall of the LV is not going to take part into ejection of blood or the stroke volume or the cardiac output. So only the remaining LV is going to contract so as the cardiac output happens. So it is very important that you pay attention or you see what is written in the echocardiography report, because that will tell you exactly where your patient management has to be changed. If you see this, this LV is thinned out. It is not thickening at all. Yes, and the walls are not coming inside either. So this is something 25%, 20-25%, I may say, by eyeballing this visualize and what we see, by visual impression, this is called as eyeballing. So this is eyeballing, and by eyeballing I can say this is 20-25% ejection fraction. Now my dear friends, just tell me how much it is. You can type in the comments, what do you say, how much is the ejection fraction just by eyeballing? It's hardly 10-15%, isn't it? The walls do not thicken, they do not come in the center. So this may be cardiomyopathy, dilated cardiomyopathy patients. These patients are actually candidates for heart transplants, but sometimes we have to deal with them for CABGs also, or you may have to deal for orthopedic procedures also, because emergency they can land. So that is why we have to be very particular about these patients. Now, we are not echocardiographers, so are we going to see only the echocardiography and understand the report or read the report? We have to implement it in our anesthesia management. So our goal, main goal of anesthesia, when we say we are managing a severe LV dysfunction patient, the goal has to be mainly to maintain the hemodynamic stability, one. And how we do that is by maintaining the myocardial oxygen demand and supply, so that the coronary perfusion doesn't get hampered. Am I clear? It is very important to maintain the hemodynamic stability. That means no hypotension should ensue, and the coronary perfusion has to be maintained by maintaining the demand and supply of the myocardial oxygen, or say the blood supply. Okay, now coming to the cardiac grid, I always say, whenever we are managing any cardiac patient coming for cardiac surgery or non-cardiac surgery, or in general also in the ICUs, in the CCUs, we have to consider the cardiac grid. Now, what is meant by cardiac grid? Many of you may be knowing, but for the newbies, let me tell that cardiac grid consists of heart rate, rhythm, contractility, preload and afterload. So these are the five parameters which consists of cardiac grid. Every patient of cardiac has to be managed by considering the heart rate, rhythm, contractility, preload and afterload. Now, how is it going to affect? Why should I consider all these points one by one? Yes, for the successful management of these patients, always take into account all these parameters. First, let me tell you, why heart rate? Heart rate, they say, always has to be maintained. If you get tachycardia in such severe LV dysfunction patients, or patients with diastolic dysfunction, or any patient of cardiac or with having severe cardiac ailments, if you cause tachycardia in them, what happens? With tachycardia, basically the oxygen demand of the myocardium increases. Yes, that we agree. Secondly, what happens is, during tachycardia, the diastole is decreased, the diastolic filling time is decreased, and the coronaries fill during diastole. My dear friends, when the coronaries do not fill properly, the supply is reduced. One is because of tachycardia, the oxygen demand is increased, and because the diastole is reduced, the supply is decreased. So then there is an imbalance between demand and supply. What will this cause? This will cause myocardial ischemia. Yes, in extreme conditions it may lead to myocardial infarction, what we call as perioperative myocardial infarction. So that is the mechanism of this. Then coming to rhythm, sinus rhythm is important. No arrhythmias. Now I'll explain rhythm while talking about diastolic dysfunction, because I just explained one mechanism. You have to always keep in mind that one why tachycardia should not happen in cardiac patient. Rhythm we'll see a bit later. Contractility. Yes, the LV has to contract properly. I mean optimally. If it does not contract optimally and the contractions are reduced, that means ejection fraction is reduced. That means the LV systolic function is reduced. Therefore, the stroke volume is going to get hampered. The cardiac output is going to get hampered. And this will lead to hypotension. Now, what about preload? Preload has to be maintained. What is preload? If you want to know what is preload and how is it going to affect, let me tell you. Preload is the amount of blood that comes into the LV. Amount of blood that comes to the LV through the LA. Increase, and what is this? This LV, the volume in the LV is called as LV end diastolic volume. So please remember this term, LV end diastolic volume. When I say LV end diastolic volume has to be maintained, which means the preload has to be maintained, because if it is not maintained, if it is reduced or if it is increased, what will happen? If it is reduced, the stroke volume will be reduced and therefore the cardiac output will be reduced. Patient will land into hypotension. And if it is increased, that means you are giving a lot of fluid to this patient. And if it is increased, then the left ventricular end diastolic volume will be increased, and then the left ventricular end diastolic pressure will be increased. So there are some detrimental effects of increase in LV end diastolic pressure. What are they? We will see in diastolic dysfunction. As of now, you have to remember what happens when the preload is increased or decreased. Ladies and gentlemen, I think I am clear in explaining that if the preload is reduced, that means the amount of blood that has to come to the LV is reduced, the stroke volume will get reduced and therefore hypotension will occur. If it is increased, the left ventricular end diastolic volume will increase, so that LV end diastolic pressure is increased. Okay, let me stop over here for this. So that was all about preload. Now afterload, there's a concept of afterload as well. Because this is Facebook Live and we have time, that is why I am taking the liberty of explaining all this in such details. Because when I talk in the conferences, it is only we have 20 minutes or 30 minutes. So even if I feel like explaining all these things, there's time constraint. So now let me explain nicely what is afterload. Afterload is the resistance that the LV will get while contracting. So after LV comes the aortic valve and then comes the aorta. Aorta and the peripheral arterial system, or the peripheral circulation. So what happens is, when the afterload is increased, the LV has to work against resistance. The LV has to contract against resistance. That means it is having some resistance from where the blood will be pushed outside. So when our blood pressure is like 180 by 100 or sometimes 180 by 110 or so, this LV, a normal LV can cope up, but a sick LV cannot cope up. So then the LV dysfunction can be increased. Dysfunction can be increased. That means sick LV can become sicker. So we are not supposed to give more resistance to this sick LV. This we are discussing severe LV dysfunction cases in which we are not supposed to increase the afterload. then we are not supposed to even decrease the afterload. Because if the afterload is so much decreased, then the sick LV cannot even contract vigorously to meet the demands of this peripheral vasodilatation. Okay? So it should not tip down, the afterload should not tip down. That is, you don't want severe hypotension also, but you don't want hypertension also. A decent afterload reduction has to be done. So they say afterload has to be kept on a lower side. So that was all about the cardiac grid, and this theory applies in all the patients of maybe systolic dysfunction, diastolic dysfunction or valvular dysfunctions, because ultimately even in valves and the valvular dysfunctions, the LV gets affected, even in congenital heart disease. So everywhere this theory can be applied. Now coming to induction of anesthesia, this I need not talk more because you all manage the patients day in and day out, even of severe LV dysfunction. It is given in books, there are it is published everywhere, and we all know that the drugs like etomidate and the opioid based induction helps in this severe LV dysfunction cases. Propofol, thiopentone, because they cause hypotension, they are not of choice. Midazolam also, if it is given in higher doses, it causes hypotension, therefore that has to be midazolam also has to be checked and given cautiously. The amount of any drug, any induction agent, the amount, that is the volume of drug you should give, a check has to be kept upon that. Polypharmacy is advised actually. Speed of drug administration is something I am serious about, which, because speed of drug does matter in case when you are managing the severe LV dysfunction cases. Relaxant of choice is vecuronium, and most of all vigilance. Extreme vigilance is needed. That was all about LV dysfunction for now. RV function is not that much talked about, but when you have cases where severe LV dysfunction causes very high PA pressures and then RV dysfunction, or you have cases of pulmonary embolism, or you have cases of cardiac heart, like congenital heart diseases, yes, then RV function has to, or even valvular heart disease, mitral stenosis for that matter, the valvular heart diseases, yes, even the tricuspid regurgitations, RV function has to be taken into account. We have to take a note of what is written in echocardiography report with regards to RV function. Then also it might be written that sluggish ventricular contraction, same as the LV, same things apply to RV as well. RV may be dilated. The right heart size may be more than left heart size, and the apex is formed by RV. These things you might see in echocardiography report in case there is RV dysfunction. Now, if we get chance, we would have a talk on which chambers, how to identify in echocardiography, how to take the views. We'll see if that materializes, it would be very good, because I would like to tell you all these things, like in which view, which is the chamber, why do you say this is RV and this RV is forming apex, why this RV is said to be dilated, why this RA is dilated, and what the inferences can be drawn from this. Yeah, we'll think about this. Yeah. Now coming to PA pressures, may it be systolic dysfunction or diastolic dysfunction or RV dysfunction, yes, pulmonary hypertension is present in many patients. When the resting mean pulmonary artery pressure is more than 25 mmHg, it is said to be pulmonary hypertension, with exercise if more than 30 mmHg. With mean pulmonary artery pressures less than 30, it is mild pulmonary hypertension. 30 to 50, moderate pulmonary hypertension. More than 50, severe pulmonary hypertension. Why should we be thinking so much about it? Because these patients can any time land into pulmonary hypertensive crisis, and then it becomes very difficult to manage. Yes, Hypoxemia can occur in these patients. RV failure can occur. If they have a patent foramen oval, it may open and cause paradoxical embolism in these patients. Management: oxygenation, bag for compliance, and the inodilators like dobutamine and milrinone for RV failure. I have just named a few. There's a list of this, and this is as such a separate topic to be discussed. But these are the things that will be written in your echocardiography report of that particular patients which we have to see. Now, coming to diastolic dysfunction. Diastolic dysfunction, many a times it will be written as grade 1 diastolic dysfunction or grade 2 diastolic dysfunction. That's it. But we hardly pay any attention to it. My dear friends, why should we underline that grade 1 or grade 2? I'll tell you today. Now what happens? First is, I'll tell you what is meant by diastolic dysfunction. Second, what happens with anesthesia and what happens with fluids? Mainly what happens with fluids, that is a very important thing to know. I'll say the patient may have diastolic dysfunction if the patient's left atrium is more than 4 centimeters. Yes? If you are a non-echocardiographer and you are not doing cardiac anesthesia, should you know all these parameters? Should you know all these figures, all these numbers? Yes, you should, because the echocardiography report has a column wherein the dimensions are written, if you remember. So even if they don't mention there about the diastolic dysfunction, and we know what that this patient, now see, for example, I'll tell you the importance, where is the importance of knowing this. You have a pregnant patient full term coming to for cesarean section, okay? And this pregnant lady, or for the patient posted for a cesarean section, has breathlessness. But what we do is we account it to her full term pregnancy. Yes? And then this is an emergency cesarean section. There's no time to evaluate with echocardiography and all. Then also we call for the echocardiography. We call the echocardiographer or the medicine people, whoever are present, and they say it's all okay. But then, one is, if we know echocardiography, we can do it. That's okay. Even if we don't know, and we have echocardiography report, and the dimensions are there. This dimensions, echocardiography report, that too, which is done in her 5th or 6th month of pregnancy. And if something is near to this dimensions, you can keep in mind that there can be something related to cardiomyopathy in this patient, the dilated cardiomyopathy. Okay. Now, so knowing about diastolic dysfunction is important for normal routine patients as well, but more so in pregnant patients, wherein they can have dilated cardiomyopathy, and wherein the size of atria may be mentioned as more than the ventricles, the LV hypertrophy may be present, or even large LAs may be mentioned in their dimension section. Now there are 4 types of grades of diastolic dysfunction. Now you need not go into details of this, but let me first just tell you that what are these grades. It is very simple. The names may appear very different to you, but it is just impaired relaxation. Diastolic dysfunction. Diastole means what? It is relaxation. So in the first degree, it is only impaired. They say it is only impaired relaxation. Second, it is pseudo normalization. And third is restrictive. Restrictive means the diastole is restricted. Okay. So 3 and 4 is okay. Reversible, irreversible. Second, you don't go into detail as of now. And the first is impaired relaxation. Okay. Impaired relaxation is only the grade 1, which is always mentioned. Grade 1 diastolic dysfunction is impaired relaxation. Now I'll tell you the importance of this. Now this may be totally, this slide may appear different to you, and like, what is all these things? I'll just explain you in 2 minutes that it is so easy to understand what is normal normal function of diastole and what is abnormal. You see this normal, it is written E is more than A. Now what is E? What is A? Just visualize a LV. Just visualize a LV and a LA above. Okay. Now this LA is contracting and blood is going into the LV. LA is contracting and blood is going into the LV. Now E is the ejection. That is the first phase of LA contraction. Yes. That is causing maximum diastolic filling of the LV. Am I clear? I'll say once again. E is ejection of the blood from the LA to the LV, which is causing maximum filling during the diastole. Maximum filling is occurring during E, that is ejection. Now what is A? A is the atrial kick. You remember? You remember we have read it in cardiac physiology. Like E is the ejection wherein most of the blood goes into the LV and the remaining blood goes with a gush, and that gush is called as atrial kick. So in the first picture, what you see, the up big line or the big inverted V, that is the E, and the smaller inverted V is the A. Okay. So in the next, when the diastolic dysfunction ensues and the relaxation is impaired, what happens? This E gets reduced, and during the E, more blood doesn't go. Maximum blood cannot go. So the atrial kick has to take over, and for that end-diastolic volume to for that LV to have that much end-diastolic volume, the A has to be strong. The atrial kick has to be strong. So now here E is less than A, or say A is more than E. So the atrial kick mechanism takes over the E. So if you see like this in the picture of the echocardiography report, you should say that the diastolic dysfunction has ensued in this patient. It may be grade 1 or grade 2. Okay. So that is 1 and 2. 2 I won't be discussing in detail, because that is like you do the Valsalva maneuver and then you see if it reverses and all. For this we don't need. So you just think it is 1 or 2. Okay. When you say A is more than E. And 3, in 3 what happens? If they say diastolic dysfunction grade 3, what will that mean? That means that LA has to contract so much for the LV to fill, that this E is that big, and A, there is no, the A is very very small, because that much blood, if the A even wants to fill the LV can't take it, because there's no diastole happening. Am I clear? Now I'll tell you why it is not taking the LV. Why LV is not taking the blood in grade 3? Because there's diastolic dysfunction. It cannot be stained. It cannot relax. The elasticity has gone. It has become stiffer. So that whatever E has given the blood, that much blood has come. Now it can't distend to take blood from A. So that is why there is a big E and a very small A. And that E is also stiff. Okay. So now what will happen? That was all about the physiology of diastolic dysfunction. E and A. Okay. Some other time I'll again explain this. But I think I'm quite elaborative about the E and A mechanisms. Now you only can think what will happen if you give more fluid. Yes, that we'll see. That we'll see in diastolic dysfunction, why they are intolerant to these things. Now, very obviously, you will understand on your own वाई डायस्टोलिक डिसफंक्शन विल बी इंटॉलरेंट टू एट्रियल फिब्रिलेशन, बिकॉज लेडीज एंड जेंटलमैन वी ऑल नो इन एट्रियल फिब्रिलेशन द एट्रियल किक इज लॉस्ट, इजेंट इट? इजेंट इट इंटरेस्टिंग? इट इज वेरी ब्यूटिफुल, आई टेल यू, द डायस्टोलिक डिसफंक्शन टॉपिक इज वेरी वेरी ब्यूटिफुल, इट इज वेरी इंटरेस्टिंग. यू जस्ट हैव टू रीड इट, यू जस्ट हैव टू गो इन टू इट. Atrial fibrillation causes loss of atrial kick. So, when there is grade 1, grade 2, this and the sinus rhythm is lost. If there is atrial fibrillation, then these patients, they may behave erratically. Sudden pulmonary edema can occur in these patients, or hypotension can occur in these patients, hemodynamic instability ensues, and you can just imagine. Yes? Tachycardia, same as I have explained earlier, what will tachycardia do? Tachycardia will truncate the last phase of diastolic feeling, which is important for LV end diastolic volume, and it will again destroy the or hamper the myocardial oxygen demand balance. Hypertension, it will cause the LV wall tension to increase. That will worsen our diastolic dysfunction. So no hypertension. If ischemia occurs by any chance in these patients, ischemia is going to cause increase in LV end diastolic pressure. And when there is constrained LV end diastolic volume, like LV end diastolic volume is that much is present with stiff LV. What happens is, if you give more fluid or if ischemia occurs, the end diastolic pressure increases, and when this pressure builds up, where will it vent? It cannot go to the aortic side, because aorta is very strong, or aortic valve is very strong valve. It cannot go there. It goes through this low resistance pathway, and that is the mitral valve and the LA. So it goes into this back pressure phenomena occurs in this, and therefore the LV end diastolic pressure, which increases, will cause increase in LA pressure, and this increase in LA pressure will cause increase in pulmonary venous pressure, and the whole of pulmonary arterial system or the pulmonary venous system, and pulmonary edema will ensue. Am I clear? So any kind of ischemia which causes increase in LV end diastolic pressure or volume overload will cause increase in LV end diastolic volume, which will lead to LV end diastolic pressure increase and pulmonary edema. So the coronary artery disease or volume overload, both are bad for diastolic dysfunction patients. Yes. Again, take into account the cardiac grid and think of this in the similar way with regards to diastolic dysfunction. Everything same. I think now you all must have understood the cardiac grid, or what happens with LV end diastolic volume and pressure in systolic dysfunction as well as diastolic dysfunction. So that was about LV dysfunction with regards to systolic and diastolic. Now there are only few slides remaining, wherein I will just tell you about the stenosis and few other like IVC measurements, just one slide of each. And actually this stenosis or the valvular dysfunction, stenosis and regurgitation is totally a separate topic. We will see that, or I take a talk on or lecture on that also some other day. But just to complete this, because many patients may have associated lesions, so what the stenosis and regurgitations will be termed as in echocardiography report, we'll see. In case of stenosis, it will be written like leaflet movements are restricted. Annulus will be calcified and subvalvular thickening or calcification is present. As we see here, thickened leaflets, calcification, dilated chambers, this is the RV dilated, this is mitral stenosis patient, LA dilated, small LV. Yes, so it will be written in terms of restricted movements. You see this hockey stick appearance in mitral stenosis. This is called as LA smoke, which is also called as spontaneous echo contrast, which means which occurs due to sludging of blood and which may give rise to LA clot. So these are all the things that will be mentioned in the echocardiography report. The other echo findings that may be mentioned are dilated chambers, calcification, pulmonary hypertension, LA smoke or LA appendage clot, biventricular function or associated MR. Now what are the anesthesia goals in mitral stenosis? Taking into account the cardiac grid rate, tachycardia has to be avoided. Preferred is the sinus rhythm. If the patient is in atrial fibrillation, we have to avoid the fast ventricular rate. You must have read AF with FVR, AF with SVR. What does that mean? Atrial fibrillation with fast ventricular rate and atrial fibrillation with slow ventricular rate. Such patients with valvular dysfunction are in atrial fibrillation since many years. They stay in atrial fibrillation for years together, like 10 years, 15 years, 20 years. But then it is important that we convert. We cannot convert this atrial fibrillation into sinus rhythm instantly with drugs or anything. But then at least what we can do is convert the atrial fibrillation with FVR into SVR. That is, the fast ventricular rate has to be converted into slow ventricular rate by giving beta blockers. Contractility, controlled ventricular response, that is, maintain the contractility. Preload, normal or on increased side. Afterload has to be kept normal. Pulmonary vascular resistance should not increase, so avoid hypoxia, hypercarbia and acidosis. Now coming to aortic stenosis, you see the stenotic aortic valve over here. The calcific aortic valve does not open. So this is the gradient, 101 by 60. The maximum gradient is 101 by 60 is the mean. You see the extreme calcification here. So when you see extreme calcification, this is it, and the gradients will be so high. Coming to the anesthesia goals in AS, the rate has to be maintained, rhythm has to be sinus, preload has to be increased. Why increased? Because this is a state of fixed cardiac output. Aortic stenosis is a state of fixed cardiac output. If we give spinal anesthesia and if we give uninhibited vasodilatation and fluid is not given or is less, then the preload will be decreased. Since this is fixed cardiac output state, it cannot compensate. There's no blood to compensate. So the preload has to be maintained in this. So the preload has to be increased, sort of. Afterload has to be increased, because if the afterload is decreased and if there is profound vasodilatation, this fixed cardiac output state aortic stenosis cannot combat that. So the afterload has also to be kept on an increased side. Contractility, of course, has to be maintained. You cannot afford to decrease the contractility by any means, by due to any drugs or so. These patients of aortic stenosis are prone for myocardial infarction. We should always keep this in mind. One is because of their fixed low cardiac output state. Secondly, because associated, these coronaries also may have associated calcification. Secondly, the LV is hypertrophied in these patients, so they are prone for myocardial ischemia. Sinus rhythm is very important, because atrial kick, if it is lost, it can be detrimental, because atrial kick contributes about 40% of the LV filling. Preload, adequate intravascular volume, as I said, has to be maintained, because they are preload dependent. Afterload, avoid hypotension. Yes, and myocardial ischemia chances are very, very much high. They are potential candidates for myocardial ischemia. We have to be very meticulous while managing them. Coming to valvular regurgitations, there may be no leaflet coaptation, fluffy leaflets, and the cochlear Doppler Meshew mosaic pattern. I'm showing only this one slide in regurgitations because it is very important for us to know that in case of mitral regurgitation, if the report says that the ejection fraction is 70%, ladies and gentlemen, it is a total mislead. Why do I say it is a mislead? If the ejection fraction is written 70%, in case of mitral regurgitation patients, the main thing is that if you see, this is the blood that is going back into the LA, this is LV. From the LV, the blood is going back into the LA. So most of the blood, actually all the blood, has to go through the aorta into the systemic circulation, right? But what is happening is, since this is a low resistance pathway and there is the valvular dysfunction and mitral regurgitation, most of the blood is going back through this low resistance pathway, and just this is just like give way for LV. So the LV is contracting vigorously, but it is not contributing to the cardiac output as such. You get it? So that is why whenever it is written that the ejection fraction in MR is 70%, it means actually it is 50 to 55%. When it is written it is 60%, it might be something around 45%. So that is one thing, very, very important thing that we always have to keep in mind when we are seeing the echo report of a MR patient. Thromboembolism, sometimes it is written that there is a mass, there is thrombus or floating in the chambers. It is just like this, and this may give rise to thromboembolism also. The inferior vena cava dimensions and the collapsibility is always mentioned in the echo reports. What is that? I'll just tell you in few seconds. Like, see, this is the subcostal view, this is the RA, RV, LA, LV, and from this RV now comes, this is the inferior vena cava. This is the full length of the inferior vena cava, and if you see, just see the dimensions near this hepatic vein, yes, and see the collapsibility, if it is collapsing more than 50% or less than 50%, and then you can see what then you can judge the RA pressures and the CVP of this patients. Like, if it is collapsing, it is, that means the RV dysfunction is not to that extent still, or the RA pressures are not that high, the CVP is not that high, still it is compliant, the IVC is compliant, okay. And if it is stiffer, it is not collapsing, that means the RA pressures are very high, the RV system or the right ventricular side is in a detrimental state. So that was all about today's talk. It was the echo report interpretation, and I think I have covered most of the points that are mentioned in the echo report. I have discussed in detail the systolic function and the diastolic dysfunction because I got a chance of almost talking for 50 minutes to 1 hour, and I had to make use of it. I had to explain this LV systolic function and the diastolic dysfunction, and I hope I was successful in explaining it, and you have grasped what I have been trying to tell. So thank you very much, dear friends, for joining me for this talk and giving your precious time of almost 1 hour or 50 minutes or so, and thank you. Thank you so much.